First question, it is about 30 meter telescope. So consider the following statements with respect to 30 meter telescope. First statement, it is a new class of extremely large telescopes that will allow us to see deeper into space and observe cosmic objects with unprecedented sensitivity. And the second one, it is an international project of which India is also a member. And third one, its main objective is to study in detail about gravitational waves. This was in news basically because this telescope was the first time it is an international project and it is very, very important. And it falls under the category of visible telescopes. So when you say visible telescopes, it usually uses the visible part of the spectrum of light. So light, you all know, like different in the electromagnetic spectrum of light or normal wave, light wave, you have different things like right from gamma to radio waves or microwaves. So part of that, there is visible spectrum, that is that 300 nanometers to 700 nanometers. So that range is visible and that is being used by this telescope. So here, out of this, the third statement might appear fishy for you. It should appear because it is saying it is about studying gravitational waves. And if you know something about gravitational waves are not something that is seen. It is felt actually. So gravitational waves, if you know this LIGO detector, in the last year it was in news, that detector actually, what it did is it developed a machine. Once the gravitational waves pass through and any object or earth, it tries to squeeze and release any atom. So even earth also, it will try to squeeze and then release. That in a fraction of a second, we won't feel. So that is why to catch that, they have developed a machine called LIGO. That is LIGO of US. So that detected this gravitational waves. Okay, the third statement is wrong here. So visible telescope is something used to observe about space and exoplanets and all. So if you remove the third one, then it is the first and two are correct. And India is part of this project. That is why it is even more important. And now we'll see this in detail. Like as I said, it is one and two only. So this project basically is an international project and India is a member. And initially it is planned to be built in Hawaii Island, that too on the Mount or Mauna Kea. Okay, that is a mountain in Hawaii. Hawaii, you know, it is in 50th state of US. So there it was proposed to be built, but there was certain protests from indigenous Hawaiians. There are certain tribes who doesn't want this telescope to be placed there because it will affect their rituals and their praying sites and all. So that, and because of that protest and all, it is getting delayed by more than 5 years. So it was planned long back. So India, as being member, India is pushing to relocate it to some other alternative location or to consider the alternate one. So right now they are considering it to move from there to an Canary Islands, which is in Spain. So the second option is that. So right now it is in proposal. That's why it is in news. So now we have to know more about this telescope because two important things. It is in news. Second thing, it is the first time they are developing a new class of very large telescopes that will allow us to see much deeper, that is much farther, and also with unprecedented sensitivity. So that is why it is very important. And second thing, India is a member of this project. And there are only few countries that are member of this project. So that from that aspect also, it is important. And here you can see it is being built at Hawaii. And another important thing is this 30 meter telescope, the name itself means that there will be a 30 meter diameter mirror as a primary one. So that meter will be there. Let me show you once. Yeah. So this is a telescope. You can see here, right? So this one, the first one is a mirror over there. And that will be of 30 meters in diameter. And it will have 9 times more area that usually can be covered by a telescope will be extra covered by this one. So that's why it is very important. So these are the other features, like 12 times sharper than Hubble Space Telescope. If you know, Hubble Space Telescope is in the lower Earth orbit, that is in above Earth's atmosphere. So this is even sharper than that. That is why it is more significant. Okay. And coming back to this, and this, the main functions are it to explore like how the first stars and galaxies were formed and how universe is formed. So it is going to be, you know, develop more scientific discoveries in the future. And also certain concepts like exoplanets and black holes, which are deep in space, that can also be discovered by this kind of telescope. That's why it's very, very important. And another thing, as I said, it is an international collaboration. So all the countries like US, China, Canada, US and India, all of these countries came together and formed an organization called TMT International Observatory LLC. So that is TIO, 30 meter telescope international observatory. So this organization is right now going for the construction and coordination among all these countries. So it's a $2 billion project. Out of it, about $200 million has been provided by India as a grant. And then India is also providing about 20% of the mirrors, the polished mirrors of this telescope, and also providing certain mechanical and sensors support. So this is on a whole about this telescope. Okay, so kindly remember this. Right now it is being built at Hawaii, but there is no guarantee. They are trying to move it to the secondary location. So that is not important, but try to see the features. First thing, it observes the space objects in visible range. That is, and second thing, it has 30 meter telescope, means the 30 meters is the primary range, primary mirror. And it can see 3 times more deeper and 9 times wider the area. That is important. Okay, so these are the aspects. So now part of it, it's not just the current event, but we also need to know certain telescope ranges and different categories, like how we observe the planets. So there are, first thing you have to understand, there are two things. You can observe different space objects either from Earth or from lower Earth orbit, that is above the atmosphere of Earth. So you can categorize the telescopes into ground-based telescopes and space-based telescopes. Okay, this is very important. Why we need to put the telescope in space? This is because Earth's atmosphere will absorb certain radiations, so it will not allow them to go till the ground. So that is why you will put certain range of telescopes in space. For example, you know, UV light is absorbed, most of the range is absorbed in the Earth's atmosphere by the ozone, and similarly certain infrared range will get disturbed by pollution. So that is why you put these kind of infrared, ultraviolet in space. Whereas in the ground, you use visible telescopes or optical telescopes. Okay, these telescopes can directly observe based on the light that is passed to Earth. And similarly, you have other things like radio telescopes. Radio waves are not easily get interfered by other phenomena, so you use them in the ground. So that's why two categories: first, ground-based telescopes, and then space-based telescopes. So first we'll see ground-based, and then we'll see space-based. So in the ground-based, the first option is optical telescopes. Okay, so as I said, it basically gathers the light from the visible wavelength of electromagnetic spectrum. So it is normal what humans can see. And the telescope, what it does, the whatever the object it gets in the visible range, it magnifies and sees it. For example, now the biggest range is this 30 meter telescope, because it is amplifying even more larger than whatever we have currently. And second one, radio telescopes. Radio telescopes use radio frequency of this electromagnetic spectrum. Okay, and these radio waves are very powerful because they transmit over very long distance. But the only thing is, like, you need to be in the line of sight. So it is like similar to the radio waves that we use in other technologies. And this way also you can observe different phenomena. And other advantage of radio telescope is you can use both in the daytime and nighttime, because radio telescope is not something dependent on light, because if it is light, it will be obstructed. And in daytime, visible light is even more obstructed, because usually even if you use optical telescopes, you use nighttime to observe stars. Why? Because in the night time, the star will shine and it will be easy to observe. Whereas radio telescope doesn't have any limitation, so it can be used 24 hours. So that's why it is very, very powerful. And one of the important project right now going on is square meter array telescope. That is also radio based telescopes. Okay, so this is very important, radio telescopes. And there is in India also, we have a telescope called giant meter radio telescope in Pune. Okay, so that is an Indian example of radio telescope. And in radio interferometry, these radio signals which are captured by multiple antennas will be grouped and then formed a picture. This is an important advantage. Unlike optical telescopes, you can instead have many decentralized antennas. You will focus on single resolution or different parts of a picture, and then you combine and provide a ultimate final picture. So that way you are increasing the range. So that is the advantage of radio telescope. Next we'll see microwave. So here you can also see, like, the microwave and infrared. From here, it falls under space-based telescopes because microwave are also observed by Earth's atmosphere, and microwaves also has certain part called cosmic microwave background. So if you know, there are cosmic waves are the waves that are generated at the initial part of the universe formation. So these are very, very ancient waves. So if you understand them, detect them, and analyze them, then you will know much more information about the early formation of universe. So that's why you have space-based microwave satellites in the lower Earth orbit. That is microwave. Okay. And then infrared. Infrared is something that uses the range spectrum of infrared, that is above visible length. So below visible length, you need to know that there is ultraviolet range. After visible range, it is infrared. So infrared is used to basically learn about objects that are too cold to generate visible light. So if the objects are very cold, then they don't generate visible light, because you know that if sun is hot, then only generate different kind of spectrum, right, from visible and all. So if it is too cold, then it will not generate. So to observe them, like dwarf stars or even the dust clouds, for them we use infrared observatories because they generate at least infrared wavelength. And one of the example for this is Spitzer Space Telescope that was launched in 2003, and then we have Herschel Space Observatory. All these are in space. Okay. And then you have ultraviolet. This is UV telescopes. The famous Hubble Space Telescope by NASA is the one which is based on ultraviolet range. And this also is used to observe about different cosmic events. And then you have X-ray. So X-ray uses same X-ray wavelength or range. So and the main problem with these are X-rays are very sharp, like they contain so much energy in small waves. So the problem with them is that to capture them. So despite that, it has certain advantages in covering the range. So we have Chandra X-ray Telescope, which is now launched again by NASA. Remember, the name Chandra might sound Indian. Yes, it is Indian because an Indian scientist was his name was used for this telescope, but it is a NASA telescope. Okay, Chandra X-ray Telescope. And then you have finally gamma ray observatories or gamma ray telescopes. So they use this gamma also to find out different aspects of like stars, for example. Especially there are important things like you have pulses, solar flares, or this one, what we say in star, and one is there is a stage between star and a black hole. Okay, between that there will be certain stages. At that stage, these stars will emit very strong gamma rays, so only these telescopes can concentrate on them. So this falls under gamma rays observatory, falls under that. So these are the different ones. So try to, for now, try to remember that under ground-based telescopes you have optical, radio, and rest of all are in space-based, that is microwave, infrared, ultraviolet, X-ray, and gamma ray. Okay, so that is about categories of telescopes. Now we'll see important or major telescopes so far launched in the space. Okay, this is also important. Consider the following matching pairs of space telescopes and projects. Okay, so first one, Square Kilometer Array, international effort to build world's largest radio telescope. Second one, CHEOPS satellite to find size of exoplanets by Japan. Okay, third one, Spitzer Space Telescope, infrared telescope by European Space Agency. And fourth one, Arias Telescope, international project being built in India. I know this is very tricky. So not just tricky, it is difficult actually, because it is mostly based on facts. You can't put any analysis here. Like if you know, kindly mark. If not, leave these kind of questions. These are like last 10 questions in UPSC. Now we'll see this. So as I said, Square Kilometer Array is an, like the name suggests, it is about the telescopes which are spread over an area of about like one, it covers an area of 1 square kilometer, like one satellite covers that area. And these are like about 60,000 or something. All these small telescopes are there in desert of Africa. Okay, in Africa this telescope is there. So what they will do is they collect the data from each telescope and then feed it into a main central processing capacity. There they will generate a larger image. So what they are doing, instead of constructing a large telescope, they are building small telescopes and then using the information from each of them to build a larger one. So the first one is correct. So here they use radio waves. So radio waves is the one which helps this decentralization of telescope power. So first one is absolutely correct. And then CHEOPS. CHEOPS is actually a satellite that is launched by ESA, that is European Space Agency. So second one is wrong. And similarly, SPITZER is by infrared only, but it is launched by NASA. It was launched in 2003, and it was very famous at that time. And fourth option is correct. It is an basically project that is being constructed in India, that too at Himachal Pradesh, I believe. So that is with the help of Russia, Belgium, and some other international partners are there in this. So we'll see in this these telescopes in detail. So for now, the answer is 1 and 4. So 2 and 3 are wrong here. Okay. So this is how you have to remember. Like for each important satellite, you need to know what is the function, what they are intended to do, and who is constructing them. At least this much information is needed. So answer is D, 1 and 4. As I said, square kilometer is an effort to build the world's largest radio telescope, and eventually to cover 1 million square meters. And it is, as I said, use thousands of dishes and up to 1 million low frequency antennas that will enable astronomers to monitor the sky in unprecedented detail. So this is how they do it in a decentralized model. And then CHEOPS stand for characterizing exoplanet satellite. So this is a new telescope or new telescope satellite that is going to be launched by European Space Agency. It is not yet launched, but it is an ambitious project. And this helps in actually not only finding exoplanets, but also determining their sizes. So that is the importance here. And then you have SPITZER. SPITZER, as I said, it is already launched in 2003 by NASA. And the importance or unique feature about this is it has an cryogenically cooled infrared observatory. As I said, it is an infrared telescope. So in this, it will observe infrared waves generated, but this has a cryogenic technology where that instruments will be stored in certain low cold temperatures. That's why it is unique. And because of this infrared, right now, if you see Milky Way galaxy, the sun is a main star. Because of sun, you all know like other have certain effect of sun, and there are other stars which are bright. But there are certain cold objects at the exterior of Milky Way galaxy and solar system. So to find them, you need infrared wave observatory. So the SPITZER is very useful in finding them. Okay. And then you have LIGO. LIGO is like laser interferometer gravitational wave observatory. This very briefly I will explain. So what they did in LIGO is they will transmit laser waves from one end to other end, and the other end will receive. There will be a transmitter, there will be a receiver, okay? And this will be placed in exactly fixed positions with a great accuracy. So whenever there is a gravitational wave, every atom of the Earth will squeeze and then gets released, okay? That is a property of gravitational wave. But we will not be able to sense. As humans, we will not be able to sense. Even human body gets compressed and released, but we will not be able to see that effect. But because of the laser waves, if the sensor and the receiver also gets compressed and received, then that wave, that laser light will be disturbed. So that will be catched by this LIGO. So that is how they detected the gravitational waves for the first time. And another important feature about this LIGO is they are going to relocate one of the center of LIGO to India. So if you know, there was a project being constructed in Thani, and then there was a LIGO site also being discussed in the news constantly. So India is also going to be part of this LIGO mission. So that is about LIGO. And then you have NASA's Kepler Space Telescope. Okay, so this is very important because it is based on the TESS technology. Okay, and right now it is retired, but it has done many discoveries. Basically, it is to find out Earth-sized exoplanets. So that is external planets it is used to discover. And then you have similarly Kepler mission. So this is basically to survey different Earth-sized or less than Earth-sized planets in Milky Way galaxy. And then you have transiting exoplanet survey satellite. So this is that Kepler. So in this, what they will do is how they will find out Earth-like planets is they will try to see rotation of the planet around that star. So like we all know, if a planet rotates around sun, then there will be a blip. Like if suppose you are focusing on some object and you don't know whether there is a planet or not, but you will know the light. And if once the planet moves in front of that light, the light will get a blip. So based on that blip, they will try to find out what is the size of the planet. If that blip is for suppose certain time, and if that is same time of earth blip, then they will say it is of earth size. So this way it is about transiting exoplanet survey satellite. So that is that feature that is used. And then you have Hubble telescope. Okay, Hubble is again a telescope that is there in low earth orbit to observe exoplanets and all, but unique feature of it is it can be serviced by astronauts in the space. That is, whenever there is a problem, astronauts will fly from Earth, go there and repair it. And it has been done 3 times or 4 times till now. And right now it is going to be replaced by James Webb telescope. So this is the telescope that is going to launch in 2021. Actually in 2020, but it got delayed. And so from Prem's point of view, this year, at least James Webb Space Telescope is very, very important. So why it is important? Two things. It has a very large infrared telescope and the mirror is very large, and there is certain unique feature where there is an umbrella kind of thing to protect that satellite from solar flares, where it can contract and then open. So that is why it is very important, and it is the largest telescope that is being launched by an rocket. Okay, so study more about this James Webb telescope. So it is, and this telescope is basically function is to study about Big Bang, formation of solar system, all these things. And majorly it is an international collaboration between NASA, Canada and European Space Agency. This is about James Webb telescope. If out of all the missions we have discussed, this is very, very important. This James Webb Space Telescope. Try to see the image and all. And then you have finally the Aries telescope that is being built at Nainital in India. And it is a project between India, Russia and Belgium. Okay, so Belgium, India and Russia are the partners in this. And the important feature is that it is remote control. Like you can keep that and then you can control it from any center in between these countries. And you can use it to operate, basically to observe different exoplanets, stars, magnetic fields and atmospheric debris. And then you have SpearX, final one. So this is also futuristic mission that is going to be launched in 2023. And this basically same thing about all these telescopes. The common feature is finding out about formation of universe or life or about how the universe got expanded. So it is also same thing here. So I know this is quite like overwhelming information at one go. So kindly, when you get the slide, go through them and try to see each of this component in the form of Google images, because if I keep every mission image, then it will be all the slides will be those missions only. So you yourself try to see the visual picture and also try to know the important features of these missions, because these are very, very important telescopes that are there and going to be launched. Okay, so that is about telescopes and different types of categories. Okay, so coming back to the indexes now, the third one, consider the following statement with respect to democracy index report released recently. First one, democracy index is published annually by Economist Intelligence Unit. Second one, India has lost 10 positions and was categorized as hybrid democracy. Third one, democracy index also considers press freedom and media independence as one of the component for evaluation. So kindly, there are a few traps here. So read the statements very carefully before you mark your answer. So I hope you have done it. Okay, so here all of, unfortunately I didn't kept the correct option in the ABCD. So all the three statements are wrong here. So the ideal solution should be none of the above. It's my bad, my mistake. I didn't keep none of the above as an option here. So yeah. So first thing, democracy index is not something that is published annually. Okay. So that is why the first one is wrong. The trap here is annually. So you need to know whether that is periodic, annual, biannual or something. So you have to focus on that. That is why I kept the trap. So first one is wrong there. Second thing, yes, it lost 10 positions, but the thing is it was marked as or categorized as flawed democracy, not hybrid democracy. So second one also wrong. And third one is also wrong because there is no component of media or press being considered in the democracy evaluation. So you need to focus on the components that are used for evaluation parameter. Because the days are gone where they are just, UPSC is just asking about who releases this. Now they are going into minute details. That's why this kind of question. So here the answer is none of the above. So kindly, like, give yourself one mark or one question as right here if you are anywhere near. So the context, as I said, it is an index published, like, so far there are three or four reports that is published from 2005, around from 2005 it started. So in 2019, this report was released in January 23rd, and India slipped 10 places, like from 51, it went to 41. And India is categorized as flawed democracy. So what is flawed democracy? So flawed democracy is where you have all the democratic structures, like you have free and fair elections happening. You have civil liberties, fundamental rights, which are respected. But there are significant weaknesses in the democracy, aspects of democracy like governance or underdeveloped political culture and people participation. People participation doesn't mean only in the elections, but after the elections, like if there are any grievances, then how you participate and how you resolve. Or for example, when a law is passed, whether people are getting consultation, whether people are able to sign petitions that are getting discussed in parliament or not. This is called participation. So in all these aspects, India is very weak. So that is why it is called as flawed democracy right now. Now, hybrid democracy is something that is given to Pakistan. Okay. So that is a kind of negative thing, even below the flawed democracy. So in this, you will not have complete monarch or authoritarian system, nor complete democracy. So you'll have combination of both. That is why you will call hybrid system. And below that, or the last category, is authoritarian regime. Okay. And the first one is basically full democracy. So right from full democracy, flawed democracy, third one hybrid, and fourth one authoritarian. So India is somewhere between flawed and hybrid. That is flawed democracy. Okay. So now we'll see different things like the indicators. What are the indicators on which this evaluation is done? First thing, civil liberties. So civil liberties are like right from freedom of press, freedom of protest, all of these things. And then you have political culture. Political culture is about, as I said, like parties, like movements, social movements, political movements and all. And then participation, like voter turnout, women parliamentarians, all this. And then you have governance. This is where we are failing in the governance, like related to elected representatives having the power and determining the policies and all. And finally, electoral pluralism, free and fair elections, universal adult suffrage and all. So all these are three parameters. Always remember, civil liberties, political culture, participation, governance, and electoral pluralism. So out of this, four stages, as I've said. First, higher stages, full democracy, when score is above 8. Then flawed democracy, if it is between 6 and 8. Then hybrid, 4 and 6. And finally, authoritarian regime. This is about democracy index. And you can see overall in the world as well, there was certain decline in the democracy. Like you can see, this is the worst average global score since 2006. And the sharp regressions were happening in Latin America, Sub-Saharan Africa, and some part of Asia. Like in Latin America, you know, because of Venezuela, Brazil and all, that was categorized. And then you have, for India, the main reason why India's score decreased or India's position decreased by 10 points is because they are saying erosion of civil liberties by giving certain examples, like the Article 370, NRC or CAA. Because of these decisions, this economist intelligence unit is saying that they have ranked India's score below. So try to know the reason also. Now, as we have seen this, now you have to also see certain indexes like press freedom index. So this is also an important one, which is already been asked. And it is usually released by Reporters Without Borders. So you need to know the organization also. What is this Reporters Without Borders? And then you have Doctors Without Borders. So that also does certain kind of reporting. So kindly see them also whenever you get time. Okay. So now we'll see the other report. This is very easy one. So I hope you'll be able to mark it very quickly. So consider the following statements with respect to Corruption Perception Index. It is released annually by Transparency International. And second one, India's drop in the ranking in 2019 report is attributed to unfair and opaque political funding. I hope you have marked it. So here, yes, this index is released annually and it is released by Transparency International. So somewhere in previous year questions, this was there. Like UPSC asked who releases this corruption perception index. So it is released by Transparency International and that is that too on annual basis. And second statement is also correct here. So in 2019 report, they gave very low score for India. And the main reason for this is the electoral bonds. You all know this controversy with electoral bonds, right? So because of that, they say electoral bonds and certain other measures, this organization says India's current corruption perception among the people is very low because of this unfair and opaque political funding. So remember always this with the electoral bonds. Similarly, why the democracy index was low for India? What is the reason I've just discussed? So it is about erosion of civil liberties. So remember it with Article 370 and NRC. So democracy reason is erosion of civil liberties. And here the reason is electoral bonds are opaque political funding. So the answer here is C, 1 and 2 only. So this context you all know, like we earlier used to be 78. Now we have gone to 80th rank. So we slipped. And the parameters that are basically used by the corruption perception index is the perception that is basically of public sector. So remember this here, it is not talking about private sector or any other thing. It is only about public sector corruption. This also might be an option in UPSC. So it talks about public sector corruption, that too not the real one, but the perception, how people believe, how much it is there according to the experts and business people. Okay. So how they perceive, the perception is there. And the score is right now from 0 to 100. 0 tells that you are highly corrupt. 100 means very clean. This also you have to remember. 0 to 100. 100 is a good one. 0 is not bad one. And then Transparency International is basically a German organization. It is an NGO that is trying to fight global corruption. Okay. Then, as I said, in India and Australia, it is saying that unfair and opaque political financing and undue influence in decision making and lobbying are some of the reasons why there is decline in the ranking. And it is saying globally also there is no much improvement. Instead, actually, there is a worsening of the situation with respect to corruption. That is about corruption perception index. So this is the snippet from Hindu. So there you can see like rank, how it is like Denmark is at the rank 1. And you have the other things like New Zealand and all, which are sharing the same thing. But you can see India, like rank in 2019 is 80, and the score is 41. Like if it is more, score is more good, rank should be less. So that is the thing. So now the fifth question. Consider the following statements with respect to FRBM Act. First one, it enables the budget of union government to include a medium term fiscal policy statement that specifies the annual revenue and fiscal deficit goals over a 3-year horizon. Second one, the NK Singh committee set up in 2016 recommended that the government should target a fiscal deficit of 3% of GDP by 2020. And third one, the government can breach target during certain extreme conditions called escape clause. Okay, so now once again read the statements and mark your answer. So this is also very important for this year, this FRBM fiscal deficit, all those deficits like primary deficit, revenue deficit, these terms, and what is the state's position, what is the total debt position of India, and what is the external debt in that, what is the debt of private sector. These aspects are very, very, very important in the times of corona, because all of these are going to get worsened. That is why. So kindly see this and then we'll see the right answer here. So the first statement is absolutely correct. So if you see the budget presentation, you know that after budget presentation, finance minister will give a 3-year expectation of fiscal deficit and revenue expenditure. And if they are going to violate it, then they are going to have to give the reasons. So that's why the first statement is correct here. And the second one, this NK Singh committee was appointed in 2016. And yes, it recommended that we should at least by 2020 target for 3%. But this is not, we are not going to achieve that 3%. We are going to deviate it from. And similarly, in the FRBM Act, there is a provision called escape clause, where if there is certain conditions, then you can deviate from that target. So we'll see that in detail. So that's why all the three options are correct here. That is A. The context is, you all know, like the government has revised the target, and it said by 2020-21, the government target is 3.3% of GDP, fiscal deficit target. But there was a big controversy saying that India has already breached it and it is going to not stick by this target. This is even before Corona. Now you all know, like, government invoked escape clause not just once but twice. Okay, so now nobody knows like how much it will deviate from this target. So that's why this FRBM Act is very, very important. And why FRBM? Why we need to consolidate this fiscal thing? You need to know the logic also here. Like, fiscal deficit means basically you are borrowing some money from the market to overcome the balance that is between revenue and expenditure. Okay, so basically you are borrowing and subsidizing or putting that money to fill your expenditure. So that is fiscal deficit. So whenever you do that in large quantities, the immediate effect will be on inflation. So inflation will increase. So that is not good for India, because if inflation increases, then macroeconomic stability will decrease, because from inflation, interest rates will increase, and then it will have subsequent effect. So that's why it is not good. Second thing, if you are using the fiscal deficit to fund capital expenditure, then it is good. For example, if you are funding roads, railways, that infrastructure will in turn boost the economy. So economy will also develop. That means GDP will develop. So when GDP develops, fiscal deficit as a part of GDP, we calculate it as a percentage of GDP. So that way it is good. So that's why they always say, experts say, fiscal deficit should be mainly used to fund the capital expenditure, not revenue expenditure, not normal expenditure. Okay, so that is something you have to remember. So government, especially in developing countries, if somebody asks you whether we need to go for fiscal deficit or zero fiscal deficit, in developing countries, fiscal deficit breach is very much needed. Like, you always need to borrow to fund the capital expenditure. That is very much needed. So this is very important understanding you have to make. And but however, in developing countries, you have to balance the urge of borrowing and urge of investing in roads and railways. You have to balance this. That is why this FRBM target. So FRBM, basically what it does, it allows you to borrow, but it keeps a limit. That limit is 3% by 2020. That was the target. So initially it was made in 2003. And this is the same thing. Like, it tries to make the central government responsible for ensuring intergenerational equity. That means you're borrowing now, but it is future generations that is going to pay it back. So that means you need to make that equity as a fair thing. You will not impose more and more burden on future generations by borrowing now. So that balance, this FRBM Act is mainly trying to achieve, and long-term macroeconomic stability. So basically, it tries to put the limits on central government debt and deficits. And other thing, similarly, the states have enacted their own fiscal responsibility legislation, like many of the states have done it. And that will be measured as 3% of gross state domestic product. Like, country has GDP, the states have GSDP. So states' target is 3% of that. And if the states have to deviate anything, central government has to give the permission. So that is another thing. That is why right now this Kerala has a controversy with center, that center is not allowing states to breach this, but whereas center itself is breaching. So that is another controversy. And then one of the condition is that you have to maintain transparency about how you are breaching it, and you have to explain the reasons. Part of that, you have to submit this medium term fiscal policy statement along with the budget. And finally, in 2016, because we are continuously violating these targets, there was a committee set up called NK Singh Committee. Always remember this NK Singh Committee as a fiscal deficit related committee. So this has recommended that we should achieve this 3% target by 2020, March 31st. But unfortunately, we are going to miss even this this year. And then escape clause. So even though you have a target, there are certain exceptions also, because there are certain unforeseen circumstances. Like, for example, war, external war, or there is a national security threat, or suppose there is continuous monsoon fail and big drought, that is national calamity, or disasters, or collapse of agriculture, or structural reforms, like for example GST, are very big reforms that will have 2% or 3% effect on GDP. For example, demonetization is one such, but these are kind of structural reforms. If you do that, or if there is decline in real output growth or a quarter by at least 3 percentage points below the average of last 4 quarters. So if any of these conditions, you know, get fulfilled, then you can go for breach of about 0.5% of fiscal deficit. Okay, so that is called escape clause. So as I said, the lockdown caused severe contraction in economic output. So because of the pandemic, COVID-19 pandemic is considered as national calamity. So it falls under second one category and fiscal breach is allowed. And the last time it was also breached is in 2020 itself. You all know, like in the previous slides, if you remember, we discussed there was a corporate rate tax cut, like corporate tax was cut to 25%. So because of that, government is losing a lot of revenue. So they categorized it as structural reforms. That is fourth category. And they said, because of this, we are going to breach the fiscal deficit even in 2020. So that's how the government uses the escape clause whenever there are big impacts on the revenues. So that is about FRBM Act. So as we have discussed this, there are certain terms, like you already might have read, this is basic part of economics. So kindly just go through it. I just want to, you know, revise your brochure basics. Like revenue deficit, you all know it is an difference between revenue expenditure and revenue receipts. And fiscal deficit is the borrowings that are done by the government for the financial year. And it can be used for both capital expenditure and maintenance related expenses. And then primary deficit. This is important. Like when you subtract interest payments from the fiscal deficit, then it becomes primary deficit. This we have discussed. Like if you increase the borrowings, inflation will increase. So that will have effect and all. So kindly once again, go through these slides. So consider the following statements with respect to speed range of missiles that are in use. First one, supersonic missiles are the ones that travel with the speed more than Mach 5. And hypersonic missiles are the second fastest range of missiles after supersonic. And third one, BrahMos is world-class hypersonic missiles. This is again something, this is constantly news. So you would have heard and you would have known, I believe. So kindly mark this and then we'll see the right answer. So here, if you have seen about BrahMos or known something about BrahMos, it is basically a world-class supersonic missile, not hypersonic. So this is something you have to remember. So third one is wrong here. And similarly, basically the ranges are like sonic. Sonic means like you will have the speed as same as the sound. So it will travel with the same speed as sound. That is sonic. Sonic range is called sonic. The word is sound. And if it is more than that, then you call it supersonic. And if it is more than supersonic, that is above Mach 5. So up to Mach 5 is supersonic. If it is above Mach 5, the final range is hypersonic. Hyper means too high. Okay, that is hypersonic. So hypersonic is the last range or the final range. So that's why the first one is also wrong here. And the second one is wrong because hypersonic or the last range or the highest range, not the second fastest range. So that's why all the three statements are wrong here. So the answer is D. None of the above. Yeah. So this was in news because Russia has displayed, they have an hypersonic missile called Avangrad. And the unique feature of this missile is it travels with very high speeds of hypersonic range. First thing. Second thing, it has a feature called boost glide vehicle. Okay. Multiple reentry vehicle. They also call this multiple reentry vehicle. So what is the what is this reentry vehicle means? So basically, whenever you launch an ICBM, that is International Continental Ballistic Missile. So whenever you launch such missiles, they go in a trajectory, like they go up into the space and then because of the gravitational force, they again fall. So it is a kind of U-shaped trajectory for ICBM. But for this hypersonic missile, they also go into space, but while coming down, they just don't rely not just on gravitational force, but also certain inbuilt capacity. Because of that, they will go even faster than that, and also they will have certain controlled gliding, so they can target wherever they want, so accuracy will improve. So that is the importance of this feature. So now why this is in use? This is in use because if you develop a hypersonic missile, it is very difficult for defense missile systems to destroy it. So you have attack one and also defense system. For example, India is purchasing S-400 Triumph system. What it does, anyone, if any country, other country launches a missile, this defense system will track it and will destroy it in air itself. So that is the purpose of defense system. So if this is hypersonic range, then it will be very difficult for any country to defend against that missile. So that is the importance. So part of that, these categories are very important. Subsonic is the one which is where you call the missile range is less than the speed of sound. Okay. And well-known example are India's Nirbhay. Nirbhay missile is subsonic. That is speed less than sound. That is less than Mach 1. And you have US Tomahawk and French Exocet. Then next range is supersonic. Supersonic is between Mach 1 and Mach 3. So this is the speed range. This is above sound, but between Mach 1 and Mach 3. So if it is between them, then it is called supersonic. The best example is BrahMos. And then hypersonic. If any missile range is above Mach 5, then it is hypersonic. Okay. So there are no current system able to counter them right now. That is why there is a fear and controversy about these missiles. So try to know at least these technical terms. This is very important. And then finally, there is no question but topic here. It is very simple information. Like Nagoba Jatra, we all are very famous about Medaram Jatra, but we usually neglect this Nagoba Jatra because this is also a tribal festival and it is very important after Medaram. So there might be a question on this. So try to know this. And this Jatra is also held in Adilabad district. Remember the difference. This is held in Adilabad district, whereas Medaram Jatra is held in Warangal district or in Bhupalpalli, that area. A2 Nagaram area. Okay. And second thing, this is the second biggest tribal festival. And this is celebrated by Gond clan. This is for 10 days. Okay. And the tribes from Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, Orissa, and Madhya Pradesh of all Mesaram clan. Remember this with the clan. Mesaram clan of Gond celebrate this Nagoba Jatra. Okay. And this starts with decorating idol and starting the prayers from that on the riverbank of Godavari. Okay. And this is about that. Just associate that with the Gond tribe. And next thing you have to remember or study more about other tribal festivals. For example, in Madhya Pradesh are also certain festivals. In Northeast, certain tribal festivals are there. Try to know this because UPSC might give a mix and match pair like Medaram with AP or Telangana and then Nagoba and then different with different states. So try to know the different tribal festivals. What is the tribe associated? Where it is celebrated, how many days, whether it is annual or biannual, because Medaram is not an annual one. So you need to know the difference. So when it is celebrated. So these are the features that you have to see whenever you're reading tribal art forms, festivals, or culture.